Now in Scottish, our Scotsport League Cup special, St Johnson versus Hearts.
You and a deep orange bubble card, Dad? Dad! How will I recognise that new foreign striker we've signed? You and a deep orange bubble card,
another Scotsport League Cup special, live and exclusive from Easter Road. St Johnston and Hearts about to play for the right to join Rangers in the final at Celtic Park next month. Hi there, this is what it's all about. Tonight we'll find out who Rangers' opponents will be on November the 29th. And with me to watch the action are two of the Scottish game's most respected young managers, Paul Sturrock of Dundee United and Craig Levein of Cowdenbeath, both of course with recent connections to our two semi-finalists this evening. Before we hear from Paul and Craig, here's how each of tonight's teams made the semi-final stage. Yeah, Paul Sturrock and Craig Levein with me here in the studio at Easter Road. And Paul, of course, you started the season with St Johnstone, so you'll be edging towards them this evening, I would have thought.
Well, I'm very pleased they've got it this far, and it'd be icing on the cake personally, and obviously for everybody involved with St Johnstone to get to a final.
You were saying to me before the match that you think Sandy Clark's maybe giving them a freshness, so you're not slagging yourself off there, are you?
No, I do feel that Sandy's come in and a few new ideas. There might have been a staleness with me being there 4 or 5 years with the same players. And it shows in the result.
Craig, Hearts, disappointing spell they're going through. They really have to step up a gear tonight.
I think they do have to step up. I think there's a tremendous opportunity for them to turn their season around and progress to the final of this competition, yeah.
Well, let's have a look at this St Johnstone lineup. I think we've got that at the moment. And Paul, not really any surprises. I think it's the same team that started against Kilmarnock on Saturday.
I think it's also the same team that played against Hearts a couple of weeks ago. No, I think the back four is very solid. It's played together regularly the whole season. Midfield the same shape, and the boy Simeo is the key, because he kind of plays off of George just off the front, which could cause a few problems to Hearts tonight.
Yeah, let's look at the Hearts lineup, Craig. What do you think of this? One of two surprises. Adam is in. We don't know how fit he is, and McKinnon back in.
Yeah, I think there's a couple of names that have been pressed into action tonight. I think that Jim's a little bit concerned about his lack of goals. And I think also noticing that Dave McPherson's involved, that they're trying to steady the ship a little bit at the back as well.
Can you see Hearts making an improvement with that change side?
They'll need to, won't they?
They certainly will. But St Johnstone in great shape, Paul, going into this.
Well, they're very well organised. They play great shape. It's the same kind of players they've had for 2 or 3 seasons. They know everybody. And they'll be up for it. They're a great bunch of boys, and they play for each other, which is a key ingredient, I feel, in this day and age. And it just shows with their performances and results over the last 4 or 5 weeks.
Okay, Paul and Craig, for the moment, time to take a short break, but we'll be right back with the live action, so stay with us. Hi, welcome back to Easter Road, exclusive live coverage of St Johnstone versus Hearts, the second semi-final of this season's Scottish League Cup. Let's now join our match commentators tonight, Alan McInally. And first of all, good evening to Archie McPherson.
Very good evening to you, Jim, and I'm sure Paul and Craig would love to be involved in this game in some capacity, but the minor blessing for them is they can stay in the warmth of the studio. It is perishing cold at Easter Road tonight. It's really like Edinburgh. We are going to have a game tonight which I hope lives up to the expectation, because both St Johnstone and Hearts, they desperately want to win this competition. St Johnstone particularly may feel it's a disadvantage having to come to the capital, but they've been going so well. They haven't lost a goal in the competition yet. Of course, they've been going very strongly, only one defeat in the last eight games. There's the St Johnstone side, which is exactly the same side as played so splendidly against Kilmarnock on Saturday. Well, the man beside me, Alan McInally, predicted that 5-0 win for Rangers, but if he did that every week, he wouldn't be with me. He'd be on his yacht in the Mediterranean, so I suspect it's going to be difficult for you to judge how that team's going to do tonight.
I think it will be a 4-4-2. We've already heard Paul talking about the way they've played. They will play with the dodging. Kernahan, big dodgy, got a goal on Saturday. They'll be looking to get another one today, and looking for Samao and Aboyle to cause Hearts a few problems at the back.
Well, the Hearts team, of course, there are several changes, as you heard Craig speaking about, a little bit concerned about how to score goals. Well, that's the universal problem. And there's the team as it will be structured. We think there might yet be a bit of fluidity about that selection.
Yeah, well, the reason Big McPherson is in is because they have been, you know, not looking that great at the back. They'll play Weir, McPherson and Richards, the three main defenders. Lock and McKinnon is the wing-backs. And Stephen Adam, I think Craig's right in saying they're looking for a few goals from him. Even though he's not 100% fit, you know, him and Adam, and Hamilton have had quite a fruitful relationship, and I think Jim's looking for that again.
Well, you know, it is difficult to call this one, as opposed to, with the greatest respect to Henry, nobody really expected him to beat Rangers.
No, true. I mean, it was a little bit tongue-in-cheek with the 5-0 thing. I did say if they went 3 up front...
I thought you were deadly accurate.
Well, yes, I was, right enough. There was a few people, believe it or not, actually listened to me. But I think this, to be fair, is a much more difficult game to call tonight. Both, maybe Hearts, if anything, of the two have been more disappointing, having such a great season last season. But when it gets to this sort of situation, actually, and bonuses start to be coming to play, believe me, both teams want to win this one. But honestly, well, God, this is a hard one to call.
Well, they certainly do, and I think there's a special and personal feeling about this for Sandy Clark, who certainly left Tynecastle with, to be perfectly honest with you, a lot of bad feelings surrounding it. I think quite personally he wants to do it, quite apart from obviously being the St Johnstone manager. A player who tried his heart out for his club and our manager of St Johnstone, continuing the work of course at Paul Sturrock. The grounds that he laid down, and this St Johnstone team, as I said, played some sparkling football. Now there's Paul Kane. Now Paul Kane is the first Scottish player to have used the Bosman adjudication by coming in a free from Viking Stavanger. And of course he's in blue there, but the Hearts supporters, they see him purely as a Hibby. There's David McPherson back in 1984 as a raw teenager. He was asked to mark in the League Cup final, Paul McStay on the left side of midfield. Did it splendidly. Rangers won the game, so he's got a medal. And one of the most charming men in the business. There's Willie Young. Willie Young, of course, the man who refereed that Scottish Cup final between Hearts and Rangers. And so, set for a game, as Alan pointed out, a very difficult game to call indeed. Most impressed by the mobility of St Johnstone up front. O'Boyle and the little Portuguese player, Miguel Samao. They've got pace, versatility in the play, and they've got a wonderful substitute ready to come on. Nathan Lowndes has scored that beautifully conceived goal on Saturday against Kilmarnock. Off we go. Bit of a breeze here at Easter Road. As I said, it's very cold as David Weir gets the first solid touch to the ball. Well, Hearts can't afford to give that man the ball because his mates from midfield will be doing it, O'Boyle. O'Neill played well on the right-hand side. Ex-Dundee United player, of course. Now Kane, difficult ball to take so early in the game, trying to chest it down and get control.
I thought we had visions of the quarter final, sorry, the round before rather. He did that against Falkirk. He does always hang out to get up the scrap. Falkane took the chest there, but just didn't really hit the ball as cleanly as he did against Falkirk.
Well, smile on his face, taking the rival comments of the Hearts supporters. A genial manner. Touched there by Hamilton.
If I didn't know better, Archie, I'd say he was probably laughing at himself because he knew I was going to give him a stick for missing that.
There he is. There's O'Boyle, spreading it wide. McQuillan, very much an adventurous and progressive right back. Richie watching that very closely. For Richie, one of the younger breed coming through in Scottish football. Promising career, not just for his club, of course, but for Scotland as well. I can see that Vincent Guerra is drifting into midfield, and that's what he played in France mostly. Very useful player indeed, scorer of a marvellous goal against Barcelona in the Champions semi-final, I remember very well. So he can nick them in too. He's got a tremendous whack. Good run forward there, by Preston trying to pick it up. Certainly got the ball played well ahead of him. Alan Preston, of course, great Hearts supporter when he was a kid. But of course, when you're against your team, your childhood team, you really do put in something extra, Alan.
That's just exactly it, isn't it? Maybe he's been trying to impress. But maybe his dream of playing for Hearts might still be there, but right now, he's all St. Johnson, that's definite.
Darren Dodds, another Hibby. 6 years with Hibs. And scored a very good goal against Kilmarnock. Good in the air in both penalty areas. A lot of wrestling going on there, and I think it's O'Boyle that gets the benefit of the doubt. That seems to me about 50-50.
Well, a little bit. You can see Richie's arms are over. Actually, he's got out of that, O'Boyle, because he's just trying to make a nuisance of himself. He did enough. He gets a foul in a dangerous area.
Kane. Look at all the running in the box. We've got the bigger men up there. Kernahan came up as well. Just to the back is Dasovic, the Canadian international. Well, you can see Preston playing that jerkily there because they were bearing down on them very quickly. Nobody is going to be allowed to settle in midfield. Away by Gary Bolan. I think as Paul would know, the mix of the St. Johnson side is very much getting as high a quality player for as reasonable a price. A lot of these players, like Gary Bolan, have had experience with other clubs like Rangers for himself and Dundee United. Now there's certainly plenty room there, and that's offside. Well, you know, Alan, you've been bothered with injuries yourself. Just how risky is it to put on a striker, and in particular when you know you're not particularly sure of his fitness when he goes down?
You're clutching your straws a little bit. Well, I mean, I wouldn't think to say he's not, maybe not 100%, but he's certainly fit enough to start tonight. Because maybe that just shows he's maybe 100% fit as he strays offside, trying to nick a couple of yards there. But very scrappy opening match so far. No real passes are finding the men, and a little bit of a chess game at the moment.
Although we should point out the conditions are a bit different. It's a very, very strong, boisterous wind blowing. This man can hammer it with his left foot, except he puts it a little bit to his right. Stevie Fulton making one of the kind of positive runs that Hearts will desperately need over and over again tonight.
Well, that's what Stevie Fulton's good at, running at players. No player likes to be run at and take on, and Fulton did well. Just his touch maybe just let him down. Just that one there you just saw got across, gave Dasovic a chance to get back and clear the danger. But Stevie is very good at that, and that's what they'll be looking for. Plenty of that from him tonight, driving from the midfield.
A lot of distance in that. By Alan Main, Fulton. Head of Darren Dodds again. Now Salvatore. Pace very frantic in midfield. It's certainly not a settled game yet. Simao is brought down. Well, I suspect, Alan, he's the kind of player, he's an elusive, slippery little player, he's going to get a lot of free kicks in our game.
Well, certainly tonight, it is a windy night, there's a lot of rain in the park, it's quite soggy, there might be a few tackles going in, but he is very tricky. He showed good quick feet there to get away, Salvatore definitely brought him down. They'll have to be careful, certainly around the box of defenders.
Well, both Kernahan and Dodds have gone right into the box for this. Right behind it, David McPherson. And apart from anything else, any weakness at the back, Alan, I'm quite sure that Jim Jensen's realised the difficulties he would be in the air, possibly. That's why David's in. These two big men, Dodds and Kernan, are very good in the air.
Well, most definitely, and they've played the ball right into the heart of the box there, and Big Davy wins a header. That's exactly what Craig was talking about before the game. Bring a little bit of solidity back in. Easy to say for you.
You stick to predicting scores,
absolutely.
Right?
But that's the reason why. He wins the header, they clear the danger. Big Davy play a big part of the hearts tonight, I'm sure.
McQuillan. You can hear the boos. Friendly rivalry. Last time I saw Dodds playing was on the left side of Hibs' defence at Inferno, second or third last game of the season when Hibs are really struggling, and he struggled with them then, but I think, you know, going to a new club, it rejuvenates a player. He certainly played well when I saw him on Saturday. I was touched by Hamilton, but nobody running in behind Adam, just a little bit late. McQuillan, if you watched our edited highlights on Sunday night in Sportsport, you might have seen him acquitting himself well down the right-hand side for Kilmarnock. He judges a run forward very well. Here's Samal. No hesitation there as Dave McPherson went in again. There's McKinnon. Guerin tried to swing that away across to the left. Preston to Bolan. Oh, Richie just getting in the front. That's a better ball to Samar. The Portuguese player can open the scoring now. He dug underneath it with his nearer foot, the left one. Could he have been a little more courageous?
Well, it's a great ball through here from Dasovic. I thought really he could have taken it on his right foot. You see, he plays it with the outside of his left. And that's a little bit ambitious, I think. I think it'd been easier for him to come across the ball with his right, with the instep of his foot, and I think he would have scored there. I think a little bit ambitious. He certainly got in behind, showed good pace, but his finish is a bad one. You see here, it's hard to take the ball like that, take the ball with your left foot like that. His right foot would have been better, I'm sure it would have.
Well, he's two-footed, all right. I mean, I saw him playing on Saturday again, and he could swing the ball in with both feet.
I'd rather have seen him take it with his right.
Maybe just being a little bit too clever by half that time. Here's McPherson. Back inside by Hamilton. Now somebody should have been running right through the middle. One of the midfield men there. Preston. Well, Georgia Boyle gave the impression he would start off after that. We'll look at Rousey getting into that tackle again unnecessarily. Well, remember, Kilmarnock scored a goal against Maine from about 35 yards on Saturday, Robert scoring, and of course Georgia Boyle himself, so it's almost a vogue for the likes of players to catch goalkeepers out, and Boyle, he wasn't really even tormenting Rousey there.
So they nearly gave a goal away there, Rousey, they got out of jail, they were very, very lucky, it's a terrible clearance.
There we are, 10 minutes gone, still no scoring. Only little flickers of uncertainty in that Hearts goal mouth. Here's McQuillan, that's the run I was talking about, didn't get far that time though. McKinnon, Adam has come back very deep indeed. Wants to glide away and does. Guerin playing it around, that's good play by Hearts. They've struck about six passes together there.
And just falling. Hamilton hovering in behind McQuillan. Best move of the game.
Most definitely. Great passing play. Great ball whipped in. And that gets the fans down below us shouting for Hearts. The first real passing movement that's put any team under pressure.
Running off the ball there, it seemed to be McQuillan, but accidentally caught Adam with the arm. Guerin just gets it back. McKinnon of course can play as an outright defender on the left hand side. As a constructive left-sided midfielder. Kind of half and half tonight. Kane. And he'll give him the chance to bring that down. Samal. Good tackle, but it falls to McQuillan again. That's a poor ball by McQuillan. Given he was presented with a ball in the clear. A lot of elementary mistakes. A difficult evening for both these teams. I mean, in the sense that St. Johnstone have been playing rather well, but they've still got to prove they're winners at this level, and Hearts struggling to find form.
Well, yeah, they are. Sandy will be quite happy the way things have gone since he's come here, but most definitely Hearts have been a little disappointing after everyone thought, you know, it's basically the same team, maybe a couple of added players. They just haven't found that spark that they had last year. Not yet, anyway. But nevertheless, they could still find themselves in another final, and that's exactly what they'll be wanting to do tonight.
Jim Jeffries, the man who masterminded their effort in the Scottish Cup, and he was saying the other day that it would prove or increase their credibility if they did two back-to-back cup finals. That's what he's after. McQuillan, the Boyle, Northern Ireland international, who I think you'll remember one international game in particular when he played against Germany and played very well indeed. Friendly game. Donald joined Germany. He was outstanding that night. Adam Randwell. Look at Hamilton inside here. Well, it may have looked awkward for Dodds there, but the danger was averted because Hamilton was surely going to pick it up.
He does really well when he's in those outside areas. Stephen Adam always makes himself available. It's actually a great pass down. Big Dodds did well to clear the danger there. To Jim Hamilton has an easy finish at the back post, but he's good when he's on the outside there, Hamilton. Good delivery into the box. You see, here he gets down that right-hand side.
Here's Fulton, little chip in there, that just passed. Well, Hamilton again got into the box, this time on the right-hand side to his left foot, and that little burst of pleasure will really put this St. Johnstone defence.
Just comes a little bit awkward to him there, Jim Hamilton. He's just in front, he's got to try and hook it round. If he'd just been a yard back, if he'd just been sweeping that into the box, but this is a better sign from Hearts, they're picking the game up. It's a decent ball in, maybe a little luck it gets him. You just see it comes at an awkward angle, and he just can't hook it round into the net. We've been in target near the post, which is what Alan Main was beating.
Free kick though. The Boyle judged to be backing in that time. Swerving at Hamilton. Alan Main, who has a tendency to come out of his goals, likes to play as a kind of sweeper at times. That's why he was caught on Saturday against Kilmarnock. Yes, players finding it very difficult to settle down there. That was another elementary mistake by David Weir. Quite unsure how this game will go. Wasn't really even challenged that time. Dasovic just stood by and watched them making a mistake. Well, Hearts of a big support here, there's no question about that. St. Johnstone maybe not quite the same numbers to eventually fill Easter Road. There's Weir. given away by McQuillan. Kane. It's the kind of passing game that St. Johnstone have been attempting. Kane just running too much at an angle there off the ball. Preston, of course, sidelined by injury last season in particular. Nicely picked up. Last season I watched this man, McKinnon, playing 20 Enskede. They could be in a dangerous position here of Boyle. They like to counter-attack. There's O'Neill. Away to that far side, and Preston comes in again. Well, Preston scored against Hearts last time they played in the league, and given another opportunity here, all starting from a Boyle and in the cross ball.
Well, they've actually just stretched in there. I think it was Gary Boland that came in the back there. And Gary Locke just got in at the back post. Good play, good vision as well to catch him out there. Oh, sorry, actually, you're right, Ellis Preston. Take it back. But Gary Locke, good defending there, got back in. He was actually caught trying to get up the park, but got back in really well.
There's McPherson. Somebody finding it. Anybody finding it very difficult to put the foot on the ball, as it were. Just a little more creative. Offside. Just.
Wasn't much in that.
Took a little man. And given away again.
Plenty in that, though. But that's the problem. Okay, we know why, you know, don't want to cheat, but, you know, maybe try and steal a yard to get in behind. Tonight may be a night to try and get it into feet and build it out wide. The ball over the top, it's maybe not the ball tonight. There's an exact example. Because I think most defenses are going to be quite happy to stand their ground and let them run in there all night.
Well, quite clearly it's very difficult to gauge the wind, and certainly the swirl in the wind. I think both teams have been caught out exactly that way. As they're exasperated. Obviously want a little more possession, as Alan said. Hamilton, easily enough read, and thank God just laid off on that. Adam puts it up. Well, he turned round, and at least you've got to give him credit for getting away from his marker.
Well, initially he showed great touch there, get away from Kermahan. I'd like to maybe see him go and take the last defender on, be more aggressive, direct, tried the snapshot, just didn't work, but showed good quick feet there. And just, you can see there, just snaps at the shot, pulls it wide.
Bolton, still no real cohesion in midfield. Well, I think scrappy's an understatement at the moment. The part, as I said, a lot of recrimination about his departure from Ancastle. John O'Neill, part of the Dundee United School of Coaching, as Paul Stark knows only too well. There's McQuillan. You know, they can't even take advantage of passes given away.
Well, it was a little bit unlucky there, though, because he's been shut down very quickly, but it is very, very scrappy, as you said, Archie. There's no real flow to the game at all. They'll have to start looking. Even small passes, short passes, get the confidence up.
There's Kernahan. Well read by Weir. Back by Salvatore. Right down the side there. Adam. I think it's gone out in any case. Across that far side. So no scoring after 20 minutes. And he seems fit enough, Stefan Adam. He's alert enough to get away from his marker on that last occasion. Going to be one of these nights where we have this accumulation of basic mistakes like that.
I don't think I would blame St. attempting a dam, even though his touch wasn't good. But I think I'll blame Gary Lott there. He's thrown it. I think, you know, Jim's probably quite right to be raging. He's thrown it to Stephen Adam right on into his chest. He's the man holding the ball. He can throw it in when he's ready to throw it in, not when somebody comes short like that. That's a simple, basic mistake. Not so much Stephen Adam, more Gary Lott.
And that's given away again by Fulton. Now, O'Neill trying to take advantage. Here's Preston playing with that determination again. He gets a free kick. Now, I would judge the wind probably aiding St Johnstone at the moment, so they could capitalise on this, surely.
Even though it's about, what we've got, 35. I don't know what Paul Kim will think. Remember, we've got the big guys up there, probably looking for a knockdown.
Well, they're certainly on the right-hand side of the penalty area. Plays it square, he's an eel, he'll get underneath it again. And that was making it very difficult for him, because Vincent Guerra read the danger and came across and partially shut him off.
Rather have seen him club it to the back post. It's a bit of a battle at the back, but Guerra did well not to close him down. But even then, it's only been really a half-hearted hit. Never troubled Rosie's goal at all.
Clearance by Rusi, held back by the wind. Just kept in play, Guerra. Now, Salvatore, there is a bit of space for him this time. Fulton. Hamilton. Given support by McKinnon. Oh, that was played in with a hope of something happening. Not precise enough. I think that's been the story of the passing so far. Guerra crept off the ball, just a little bit unfortunate. Obviously, I've got a lot of respect for Guerra. I'm not quite sure if he's fully attuned to the Scottish game yet, but he's a shrewd little player. As I said, packs a fair dig when he gets going. I mean, quite frankly, this sort of game is foreign to him as well, Alan. I mean, he played in the Paris Saint-Germain team, which played the ball on the ground all the time, hardly raised it off the surface. A lot of passing.
Well, Jim would be wanting him to get on the ball, get the passing going. He starts, I'm sure everybody else will follow suit, but quite honestly, it is a difficult night for the guys with the wind. And although the pitch, must be said, it's a good night, except the wind makes it that little bit more difficult.
Gary Boland with it that time, neatly touched inside, probably coming forward for it though. Julie say, being watched there by Sandy Clark, who's retaining an impassive demeanour on that far side. Now McKinnon, give him a little bit of space, here's Guerra. Hit it off neatly, tried to come in for it again, Hamilton. Pushing it back though. Salvatore, that's better play by Guerra, and he threw almost free kick. This time could be dangerous. And that emanated from the little Frenchman with delicate little flick for which he's renowned.
Well, I said he's looking to get him involved, get him passing. He's a bit of experience, he's going to find the man. A lot of lovely little passing in there. Jim, the ball almost gets caught in his feet. Goes in direct, that's what I like from a striker. Go and take your defenders on, make them make the decision. The decision was they brought him down just at the edge of the box, and Hearts have got a free kick in a dangerous position. Kenahan got a booking there.
Kenahan booked. Now we have Guerin here, we have Fulton. Fulton with an explosive shot, of course. He's already scored 3 goals this season, Fulton, and he's going for it again. And ironic cheering from behind that St Johnson goal. He didn't get hold of it. Leaning back just a little bit. But they've got to take advantage of these situations in such a tight and negative game.
Well, you certainly have happened in many opportunities, really, Hearts. Been restricted for a bit, but that was probably the best opportunity tonight from a dead ball situation. But Stevie will be the first to agree, he did not catch that quite right, did he?
Well, assisted. Hamilton might have touched it just behind him. He had McKinnon there. Well taken down by Salvatore. Not too many passes given away by Fulton in particular. They're looking for Giorgio Boyle again. Weir is there, not making a good job of it. Tries to touch it into Samau and away by Weir with that recovery. And the flag is up. The Hearts bench not greatly enamored by that. In hard end, the referee has had to bring that to a halt for that tackle.
Rob knows he's going to tackle behind like that, no chance you're going to get away with it. Such a daft free kick to give away, didn't need to do that, he could have just shut him down.
Zima, way to that far post, a very good one, it troubled the defence. That's away, the goalkeeper deciding not to come out. Sometimes too many of these balls have been put too near the goalkeeper.
Yeah, but that was a good ball. Great ball to the back post. No chance of Rousey coming to get that. I think maybe we'll just make sure it goes nowhere far by the post.
George didn't get the touch. Kane touches it away. And again, good play by Kane. And I think there was a double block that time. The 2 feet went in. Enraging one or two of the players, and certainly the squad underneath here. He does have a fiery kind of temperament, Paul Kane, and he gets a yellow card.
Well, initially here he does well, he gets up, tries to keep possession. There's a few players coming in, you can see definite 2 feet just through there. And takes Guerin right below the knee. I really don't think Paul can complain too much about that. He's just showing determination to try and get the ball, but we use 2 feet.
Not like that.
Exactly, you can't get away with that. And you see Guerin just caught on the shin there. That's a sore one.
I've always thought the double block meant that instantly, regardless of what is prefaced, that should be a red card, Alan. It's a dangerous tackle.
Well, it is, it's very dangerous, you're right. It's it can certainly hurt someone when the 2 feet go in like that. There's actually players I know actually can't tackle any other way apart from 2 feet. Difficult for him to be, he should know.
Name them.
No. Yeah, the two of them are sitting in the studio. No, Paul's never tackled up in his life. What's up with him?
So, free kick. Little Frenchman recovers. Might have thought immediately after that he was regretting crossing the channel, but he gets up again, all right.
Just going to say, welcome to Scottish football, although that's unfair.
Got right underneath that again. Now McKinnon. Guerra. Well, Salvatore not alert to that. The little Portuguese player was Dasovic. This was the kind of play we saw at Comarca on Saturday. St. Johnson pushing the ball around confidently like that. Good tackle on the far side though.
And he played with a bit of pace, as Samuels showed there. It's going to cause you problems, but if you can restrict him to using it out as wide as that and let Big Davy Weir shut him down before he gets a chance to run at you, I'm sure Big Jim Jeffries will be quite happy with that defending.
Well, I think this has roused the Heart support, though, that little incident. Weir. A nice position he was in on the edge of the box, and nobody beside him. There's Guerin again. His tidiness and neatness might be one of the features and the difference between the two teams. Stevie Fulton's not having one of his better nights. There's McKinnon. Now he can get it to his left foot, and at least it's a shot at goal. And there was a bit of movement and mobility about Hearts again.
Well, he's got a good left peg, Rob McKinnon. Does well there. Haven't seen him score many goals from there into row E. But what I would like to see him is when he gets a chance to go down this left-hand side underneath us, Archie. I want to see him go and attack players. He's got a loop of good left foot, swing it into the box for Adam and Hamilton. Although, I suppose, he's right to take a shot there, but no chance. We did say it would be close tonight. It certainly is. Not much in goal chances so far. Really, a goal would just set this up nice, wouldn't it? We just need that, just to try and start firing a few of them up.
Winner. Pushed away brusquely that time. O'Neill, too square, too fast. And a bit of running off the ball there by players. Hamilton, Adam should pick it up and does, with a young waving play on. There's a good run forward by O'Boyle, and again the linesman just underneath us here with his flag up. There he goes. That's three times O'Boyle's been caught out like that. He is that kind of player that, you know, if you give him on playing on the margins, by the law of averages, you might get away with one.
So far, the Hearts have been lucky, but certainly with the pace of Boyle's, he's very cunning. A Boyle is a good player.
That's
what
Hearts
pace.
That's what Hearts don't have at the other end of the moment.
No, they don't. But I'd like to. What the Hearts are not doing is really playing too many feet. It's all long. Hamilton hasn't really got his timing in yet, and not enough into Adam's feet to try and build and get McKinnon or Locke down the flank to get crosses in. They haven't done that at all yet, Hearts, and I'm sure Jim Jeffries will be pointing that out to them at half time.
Well, it's trying to be a little bit too obvious that time. O'Neill, Fulton, still not terribly sure of himself tonight. Stevie Fulton almost giving it away again. Samal hovering at the back. That little elusive touch that he has might be another turning point of the game, the more he gets the ball up front. And here is McQuillan. It is Samal. Well, Richie might have considered that was shoulder to shoulder that time, but again they concede a free kick in what should be a very useful place for St Johnstone.
It's more clumsy by Richie there. He just bundled into him. Samal doesn't take a lot to knock him off the ball, but Paul's just almost jumped into him there. And another opportunity for St Johnstone to try and create something. The big guys are up on the back again.
When you get a wee player like that, it's almost like bullying, isn't it, when he goes in hard against them. Anyway, here's the free kick. Very poor when the last one attempted. Alan Preston with it. Running over to O'Boyle. Well, you felt they were going to get themselves in a bank, but they didn't get all of the ploys in front of a crowded area. Alan, have got to break up a defensive wall.
Well, it's obviously something they've tried. One, it's not wide enough. You can see the players are over from the wall enough to block it, and Josh quite simply doesn't get enough turn in the ball to try and get on target.
If they're going to play the ball wide like that, it's got to be a cross in to go, isn't it? Well, that's not a shot to go.
Even there, I'm sure there's work to be done in that, in the tuning part. I think they could even have another man even wider than that to help Josh.
O'Neill, Boyle. Well, he's trying a long one. As they say, he did score a spectacular goal a couple of weeks ago from about 40 yards. Little man, as I said, played splendidly against Germany in a friendly international. That's anybody's game at the moment, and he knows it. Adam Salvatore. 10 minutes of this half remaining. Gary Locke. Well, you could see he was in several minds waiting for support. Here's Guerra. Plays it simply. And Adam can't pick it up. Here's Fulton waiting for the shot. And again it's snatched. But at the very least, the ball was played from left to right. A little bit of change, trying to wrong foot this defence.
But the whole move actually has come from when Adam, the ball has been played into his feet. He plays it back, it's played out wide. It's okay, the cross is in, defended reasonably well, and then they get a shot. But when the Hearts do that, they look in control. They've passed the ball better so far, and they've got to look to hit Adam and Hamilton early so they can get support and get the ball out wide and stretch St Johnstone at the back.
Free kick. There's a bit of a wrestling match going on there. So, Gary Boland, a lot of curl in that, but not particularly well directed. Just touched away again. Most of the free kicks have been disappointing thus far, and here, Samar. Neat little jink across there. Nobody coming in from the far side for St Johnstone. And then it goes to Hamilton. Got to pass it to the left, he has Bolton there, and just swept away there. Dodds, just coming in. Now Ritchie, he hasn't progressed all that much into the St Johnstone half. Now Kane. Tackle there by Weir from the back, and I think he's certainly going to teach one or two lessons to this man. Kernahan, Samal to Kane, might be figuring in a Davin goal, there was a touch there I thought, certainly Kane is claiming it, we shall see now as he comes through here.
I can't believe that's most definitely a corner kick, I'm sure that came off Ritchie there.
Well, that wasn't much of a complaint.
Definitely a corner kick, Paul was quite right. Well, the young get the glasses cleaned at half-time.
Mark you, it was a very gentlemanly and subdued protest to the referee, given what's happened to him. Adam Adams. Free kick. As you can agree with that. Will Young taking a very firm grip of this game tonight. Ritchie. Well, Kane does a lot of neat and precise work in midfield, like Guerin as well. Harder tackle than Guerin, but that was meant for Locke. Wasn't all that far away, and there's that tendency of Alan Mayne, and indeed, I think, hunger to come out of goal as often as he can.
Alan Mayne was magnificent, I'm sure Paul Sonnet will agree with me, last year was superb. One may be a little surprised he hasn't pushed himself back into the Scotland reckoning, although maybe as second or third choice now.
A lot of depth in that one, Hamilton. It cuts it back. Uncertainty until it all ends with that rather reckless overhead attempt at goal there. Here's Hamilton going up. Well, it's a sore one of the best of times, but in this freezing cold night, or maybe it's numbed, he said, the cold, and he didn't feel it just as badly as normal. Trying to get a bit of depth into that, away by Weir. McPherson rather slack, he took his eye off it. O'Neill going for the 1-2, beautiful move. It must be no, great save. Oh, he cannot believe he missed that chance. And Gilles Rousseau, with a little touch there reminiscent of that brilliant game he had at Rangers. Only a couple of weeks ago, well, that desperate save.
Well, it's a great move, isn't it? Superb save by Rousseau.
Still the danger, Dasovic is there, and it's off the line again. And back to Rousseau, and if you're a good goalkeeper, you sometimes deserve luck as well, and he certainly had it there.
Unbelievable, Guerin knows nothing about that on the line. Drops into Rousseau's hands. Great spell from St Johnstone. It was a great move by O'Boyle and O'Neill. Thought for a minute when he took it by Rousseau it was going to be a goal. Rousseau stretched each frame and made a fantastic save.
Mark you, he should have scored. I think it was a slight hesitation. Simao the best 2 or 3 minutes that St Johnstone have had in the game.
You can see he had a great 1-2. O'Neill keeps his run going. Great shape there, turns inside. He thought it probably too easy. Rousseau does superb. saved the season so far. Fantastic whistle.
Back it goes again to Dasovic. He can't stop that one. The Canadian international caps the best moments of the game for St Johnston, and the brilliance of a French goalkeeper was fully exposed that time when his save brilliantly saved Hearts, and then no chance with this.
Well, I said it was a great spell that we're having, and then finish this off with a goal. Lucy, no chance here. It's only half clear. That's the touch from, I think it was Kernahan. Dasovic hits that sweet, nice. No chance. You can see here, full on the volley, too strong, and this time Roussey cannot stop it. 1-0 St Johnston.
Arma Kimmett. What will the Hearts' response be to this? McKinnon tried to make that dive down the left-hand side. Well, if you could have a brilliant goalkeeper stemming the tide, and then no chance when he's exposed like that. It'll be very difficult for Hearts to get back into this game, even this early, playing the way they've been playing. But here's McPherson. While Roussey seemed less inclined to play it away to his right-hand side, where Davey Weir was in the open. Well, Sandy Clark has been handed the baton by the man sitting in our studio tonight, Paul Sturrock, and confirm the good stability of this St Johnston side. You might have said that was the same of the season. You should have seen Roussey at Ibrox. I mean, that was quite easy compared to some of them at Ibrox before Rangers actually scored in the game.
Well, he's seven to make that.
Time in the world there for the Republic of Ireland international to touch that back. That's a bit of a push, I think, by Samal. Well, one of these games where you desperately needed the lift of a goal, and a goal coming at a very important juncture just before halftime, it does give a team a lift and a boost. O'Neill. McPherson, he had to stab it straight out of play there. And somebody in that hard side has got to rise to the occasion here in the challenge and provide some composure, especially in midfield, I think, because Steve Fulton has been disappointing tonight. A high regard for him. I think he's potentially the best of all the Hearts squad and not really got into his stride.
Maybe not tonight, but I think all of them have to show a little bit of character, and I'm sure Jim will be looking for that. The board says 1 minute of extra time played, and Jim will be looking for some kind of response in that minute before they go into half-time.
Here's Samal, gets it away, 1 minute extra. Given time to bring that down again, Preston. There's Gary Boland going to the left-hand side. Preston letting fly with an order to magnificent goal! Preston, who previously scored against Hearts in the last game, as I said, he was a Hearts supporter as a boy, but he'll feel no anguish about the way that went in, like a projectile. Super.
Well, if I thought we'd save the season, I think we might have missed the goal. Bowling does it run, he decides to take it on another couple of yards. Nobody shuts him down, Salvatore came too late. Take that, that's a postage stamp job. A superb strike by Preston. He struck it really sweetly, and you can't save them. Right in the top corner, 2-0, and an absolute peach by Alan Preston.
Watch the way he goes for this again, Alan. He seemed to go with the right arm for it, the near arm, which lowered the body a little bit.
Quite honestly, I don't think any goalkeeper would have saved that. A fantastic trick. Not only that, but being accurate, but he hit it with so much venom and pace, it flew off his boot.
Here's Brenner. Long and high, and a boil doesn't even bother running for that. It's St Johnson now take what I would imagine is a very commanding lead into the dressing room. And they'd say 1-0 is going to be difficult for Hearts based on the way they've been playing, but now at 2-0, that's a very steep incline they face. They say there's a slope at Easter Road. Well, they'll actually be playing down the slope, but it will seem like the north face of the Eiger, given that score line. McPherson. And there goes the half-time whistle. As I said, a very commanding scoreline. St Johnson would have been absolutely delighted if anybody had predicted before the game that's what the half-time score would be. Dasovic breaking the deadlock with this shot here after he had held them out with brilliant saves, but denied that time by defence that had opened up and allowed Dasovic to come in and score that goal. And of course, that was but nothing. That was very simple compared to the goal that Preston scored. And at halftime, as we go back to the studio, it's St Johnson leading by 2-0.
So there we are, as Archie said, 2-0 to St Johnson at halftime. The Perth team really in the driving seat. The thoughts of Paul Sturrock and Craig Levine coming up right after this short break. Hi there, welcome back to Easter Road. St Johnson leading Hearts by 2-0 at half-time. Paul Sturrock and Craig Levine watching that first half with me. And Paul, really, St Johnson in the driving seat now.
It did. They started very, very well from kick-off, actually. Kept their shape very, very well. I don't think Alan Mains had a save, and totally merited the result at half-time.
And Craig, Hearts did change the system before this match, and you have to say in the first half it didn't work.
Yeah, I think they changed the system to try and make sure they didn't lose goals. The problem they've got now is how they're going to score some.
Yeah, well, let's say first chance fell to St Johnson, and it was a man you signed, Simeo. Let's see how he takes this one, Paul. Sorry, I don't know if we're going to see that yet. Here we are.
This is actually the goal from Dasovic. Yep. No, he normally has a nosebleed being up as far up the park as this, but I'll tell you what, he takes it very, very well, keeps it down in the volley, and he gives Roussey no chance.
Yeah, it's an absolutely fantastic finish, Craig, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a good strike. The important thing is to keep it down there. There's a lot of bodies in between the goalkeeper and the player who's shooting. That was a good goal.
Yeah, you've been well impressed by John O'Neill in the first half, haven't you, Paul?
He's been outstanding. I think the most outstanding player in the park. His use of the ball, his linkage to the front players, and obviously the opportunity that he makes for himself, a 1-2 with Georgia Boyle's different class. For me, he's been the best player on the show.
And really, goalkeeper Alan Maney's had very little to do tonight, which is surprising.
Not really. As I said before, St Johnson have got a fantastic defence. They work very well together. They're very solid as a unit, as far as the eight players, and the four midfield players and the four back players are concerned. And they catch people on the break, they suck you in, and to be fair to them, you know, they've had four or five chances. You know.
Craig, the second goal, Alan Preston, I mean, a superb shot, but would you fault the Hearts' defence here?
Well, it's difficult to say the Hearts defence was at fault. You're looking at, what, 30 yards at an angle? That's a wonderful strike right into the very top corner of the net. They maybe could have closed them down a touch earlier, but you've got to put your hands up and say that's a good goal.
Yeah, as Alan McAnally said in commentary, postage stamp.
Yeah, so as I say, Alan Preston has that kind of finish in him. He doesn't probably use it as much as he should do, but to be fair to him tonight, he's come up trumps and you know, to go 2-0 in so late on in the half must be a killer blow.
Let's have a look at the statistics from that first half action. 2 goals we know for St Johnson. The corners fairly even, one apiece. 2 shots on target and 2 goals for St Johnson. You have to take your hat off to that. 5 shots off target. Hearts, surprisingly, 4 efforts off target. I can only remember a couple of them. Paul, you would not fancy St Johnson to lose 2 goals now.
Well, they did on Saturday, I heard, but in a normal circumstance, that type of team don't lose those types of leads. I think we had 9-1 victories last year. I'm very, very confident they'll hold on to this, and I do feel, unless there's dramatic changes in the Hearts system and thoughts, that they'll go on to score more.
Okay, Paul and Craig, for the moment, thanks very much. Full live coverage of the second half coming up from Easter Road in a couple of minutes, straight after this short break. Welcome back to Easter Road. It's St Johnson 2, Hearts 0 at half-time in the second League Cup semi-final. Craig Levine, can you see Jim Jeffries changing it for the second half?
I think he will change it, whether he changes it from the start of the second half or within the first 10, 15 minutes. But 2-0 down, things weren't working the first half. I would imagine that something will change.
OK, let's go back now to our commentators for the second half. Alan McInally and, first of all, Archie McPherson.
Thank you, Jim. And St Johnson are 45 minutes away from their first appearance in the League Cup final in exactly 30 years. 7 years ago, Bradley Old scored a goal against St Johnson. Their only appearance in that particular final. And not at all surprisingly, Hearts have made changes with Thomas Klogel and a little Angolan player, Kitongo, both coming in to see if they can invigorate a Hearts side that has been playing in a rather stodgy fashion. They need something very, very special to pull back from 2-0 at halftime. But as we heard from our panellists, where are the goals going to come from, Alan?
Well, that's a good question, but I've already seen Gary Locke just pointed to Kitongo to get down that right-hand side. So they obviously want to get him wide and get him going at Gary Boland down here. So I think we'll be seeing Kitongo on the ball a lot, using his trickery to try and get the ball into the middle for Hamilton and Adam.
Well, he's certainly a very tricky player, but he's a fragile player as well. But we've seen already the other Portuguese player. They know each other, by the way, Miguel Simão and Kitongo. They both played against each other when they were in Portugal. They're both rather fragile players, but they're tricky and elusive at their best. And at the moment, the only elusive thing that you could say about Hearts is actually getting to the final itself. That seems to be slipping away from them. But could we be in an amazing comeback in the second half? I think I should remind people in Perth watching this program that St Johnson will lead by 2-0 on Saturday. And pull back to 2-0, although a penalty and a long lobbing goal and an own goal. Rather unfortunate it ended up the way it did. There's Adam Weir. There's Kitongo. Simão and the both players together there. Trying to go hard in. And the Hearts supporters now trying to get behind the side. They need every encouragement, every resource to pick themselves up from this. Oh, and there's Hamilton with a chance, appeals for a penalty kick, but there is not a single protest from a Hearts player. Maybe from behind the goal, but not on the field.
Well, Jim got the ball through. It's going to be a late tackle on him, but I don't think he's really taken him away. I suppose I'd have been shouting for it right enough, but well, he decided not. I think it's fair to say that Hearts are going to have to be at their best, actually, to get back into this, because they've just not really been up to it tonight. Not yet.
And quite astonishingly, they're still looking domestically for a win outside Tynecastle this season. The away syndrome seems to be affecting them. Kitongo. Gary Locke. St Johnson claiming he brought that down with an arm. And there's again another missed pass by Fulton. Simão gets it. And John O'Neill, highly praised by Paul Sturrock, almost busting through the middle there.
This could be interesting in the second half, Archie, because they're taking a chance, Hearts. They're pushing McKinnon on and Gary Locke into midfield, and they're going 3-2.
And here's the boil. Well, it's risky, but they've got to try something, Alan. I mean, they were in a kind of moribund state in that first half. They seem to be able to get themselves, whip themselves up into a lather, which is what's needed for a cup semi-final.
Well, they've got to go like that, and they've got to go into push to try and get the ball in midfield. This is not 3 points we're looking for today. This is a place in the cup final.
Fulton. Hamilton's not offside. He needs a neat little chip across goal. He goes for the low one. Just Kitongo simply got in the way. I think the Weir jump forward. That was a disappointing finish by Hamilton there. To put it into a ruck of legs wasn't the right option.
Well, if he was in the middle, he'd be looking for a little dink to the back post, and all he did was drive it into the bodies. You're looking for a better quality ball, or to pick someone out at least.
Locked. Oh, very say the Portuguese player is beginning to mix it.
It's definitely a failure.
Yeah, I think he's joining our culture splendidly.
I think it helps with 2-0 up.
And then doing a bit of screaming there. It's towards him and he does get it at the second attempt there. He created a St. Johnstone record by turning in 8 consecutive clean sheets last season for a play like that.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of Alan Mint. He's done very well at 33 years old, but most definitely just coming into real good performances time and time again for St. Johnstone.
Dasovic, Kane, playing more centrally than at all. Here's a boil on the break. He has Samoa inside. There's the Portuguese player. He was just one step too short. Delightful play again by the Northern Ireland international.
This is exactly what we said. This could be fun and game in the second half. So decent ball in. Samoa just can't get there. Big David Weir gets over in time. We're going 3-2. We're going to be very careful, Hearts.
I say, I know he had that awful tackle, but Kane has been playing very usefully as well tonight for St. Johnstone. Here's Locke, Kitonga wants to go at Boland, as claiming that Boland cut right across him. Kitonga still going in though. Credit the young player, and he gets a corner kick, and the Hearts supporters behind the goal loving that. The sheer perseverance of the man.
And apart from Stevie Fulton's run in the first half, this is the first time any Hearts player is taking MD on from St. Johnstone, and that's what they want from Hearts and Kitongo.
At his best to wriggle in. That's the corner again. Weir is, and McPherson's up there now. George O'Boyle, there's the break again. It's 2-1, in fact, on the halfway line. O'Boyle picks it up. Samoa going forward. George O'Boyle with his head over the ball and up on this far side, Callahan. Well, that was a very astute break by the big fellow, O'Brien. O'Boyle from the north of Ireland sent it across the border there. Callahan was steaming up.
The only difference is he hit it right into the Irish Sea.
So, a little bit of a template being set for the second half, and that is that Hearts are being certainly much more aggressive and adventurous in pushing players forward, but we've seen the danger of the breakaways. Kitonga. Weir. Settling for the throw-in. Certainly a goal in this first quarter would help the Hearts cause enormously. Samoa was brought down there by Kenahan. McQuillan, O'Boyle. Yes. Sandy Clark must have enjoyed that second goal in particular. Well, any purist would have, but I think when you get that second goal just before half-time, you've built yourself a very significant bridgehead. Now Kitonga getting too much space there. As far as St. Johnstone are concerned, weak finish though. That's the kind of play you must compliment Kane for. But set up well by Locke. Now Fulton with the drive. Well, you have to say about him, Alan, that at least some of the passing are just a little bit crisper than it was in the first half.
Well, it's a good build-up. They played it into Big Jim's feet. Big Jim laid it back first time. Stevie took it on and had a pot off the target, but that's what they're going to have to do. I said it in the first half. You're playing with a striker like Jim Hamilton. He likes it in there, but he does hold the ball up well. So does Stefan Adam. They need to be bringing him into play. Combination passing. Get the ball out well to Kitongo and get him delivering good quality balls into the box.
Boland. O'Boyle keeping his eye on it. So does Richie, though. A real test for Paul Ritchie tonight. Locks up beside us, trapped by Alan McAnally. But in the good tradition of football,
that'll be the first time then.
We're keeping the ball. A little souvenir for us. Peels for a hands that time. McQuillan maybe a little bit fortunate to get away with that, actually. Perhaps could have picked that up and progressed dangerously. It's a game, of course, that could go to extra time and penalties. As Weir, Adam, God's with him. That's a goal kick. Yes, I think a correct decision by the assistant linesman down in that corner. Oh, tussle there with Dodds.
Both of them don't know where the ball are. A little bit of luck that Dodds got there, but that's the kind of run you're going to have to get Stefan Adam into that corner, holding the ball up.
Way by Weir. Good running by McQuillan. Saw the opportunity to get down that right-hand side. Well, he hasn't come forward all that much, McQuillan, tonight. I think he's obviously that touch of caution because of the status of this game, but he can do it. A great plays by Simon, who tries to lay it back there to Kane. Well, you know, that's a very poor ball forward, Alan. I think you pointed out at halftime, we were discussing it, that the ball really has to be played to foot and passed accurately.
Well, it's shelled forward, really, and there's really no chance Jim's going to control that.
Bolton not into it. Dave McPherson is. There's Adam. Weir's last two efforts at passing have been disappointing. That's a better one. Opened it out rather better that time. Logo. Too many of the balls played in towards the edge of the penalty like that by Hearts have gone astray. I think a lot of that self-belief that we saw in Hearts towards the end of last season, which helped them to win the cup, has evaporated.
Well, even just in the run up the wing, you're talking about McQuillan, there seems to be just that little extra quickness in St. Johnson, and Hearts look pretty laboured at the moment.
That's a better ball in. Locke is in there, and Hamilton tried to bring it down and turn all in a one movement. And certainly they'll be hoping to get a kind of break in the game, put them back in contention. Locke. Simao. I went straight into the ball, Gary Locke. Adam. Low goal on, and Hamilton had run the wrong way.
It's been one of those nights for the two of them. They just haven't managed to get it as a partnership yet. One's getting the flick on, the other one's going long, the other one's going short. And sometimes it can happen like that, and they really need a little bit of a break. For St. Johnson, at the moment, are looking pretty comfortable.
Give him plenty of time to bring that down. Weir. That's a better looking ball. The two are after it, but Dodds is into it. Locke pushing forward a little bit more in this game now. Kitongo. Alan Preston, scorer of a glorious goal, coming back. Preston can play virtually anywhere down that left-hand side. Here's the counter-attack, Kane comes away, referee wisely, waving play on. Now a ball. Preston giving support, a difficult ball for Preston though, not well judged that time. Ball has gone over though. Well, you've seen it before in a game where the team isn't playing well, they also don't get any break at all. And it seems to be that kind of accumulation for Hearts at the moment. free kick. Little touch of exasperation creeping into the play. Sir Johnson scores behind that goal. Paul King suddenly blotted his copybook with that tackle, and there's Rusi, but he has played outside of that. Has played in that very measured, calculated way of his, which has been a big influence. Preston. St. Johnson will be happy if the game stays like this. The ball rather centered right about midfield without anybody making too much of leeway, but that comes to O'Neill again. Kernahan. Good understanding there as O'Neill ran way out to the right. Right out of support though. Logo playing on the left-hand side, the Austrian international, McKinnon. McKinnon's not the dynamic player I can remember a couple of years ago, and indeed the player I saw for 20 Enschede last season in the Dutch league. But one off his play at the moment.
I think that can be said about all the Hearts players that you pick on last season, actually.
Here's Katongo. He tried to lay it off for the 1-2 with Adam. That's good skill. Hearts need more of that. Yes, you'll get the free kick for that. And I think it was a free kick, but on the other hand, lucky to, was losing touch with the ball.
He's done well to dive and top of Kennedy. He actually shows great skill here. Turns in really well here. Justin, he tries to put it over the other turn. Got to say that Alan Kennan's made sure he's not going to get that. But good skill by Katongo there. Another opportunity for Hearts in a good position.
Well, they're down the slope. They've got a win at his back. And Fulton, can he lift this game up from what has been a very mediocre performance by his own standards? Wants to lay it to the side, and he does. Disappointing ending yet again. Half-hearted look about that, Alan, again. Here's the break. Samao! And sliding right across there, coming in very hard. Here's Kane again. Preston. Try to get it to his right foot this time, which isn't quite as potent as his left. Giving that away to Bolin though. Dasovic. Saw Dasovic playing four times for Canada, would you believe, in the lead up to the World Cup, but the Canadians were so anonymous you came away not knowing which player was which, in a sense. But here he is in Scottish football now, played his part, scored that goal. There's a touch inside, there's offside, I think. Well, you would think, as that ball's played forward there, you would think a sense of urgency now has to creep into their game.
Well, definitely. Just again, straight, just offside. It's just one of those nights for them, isn't it? It's just not going to happen. They're trying to get inside, trying to get in behind St. Johnston. It has to be said that they've actually defended well St. Johnston tonight. And you heard Paul Sturrock signalling out John O'Neill. I think Keynes had a superb game tonight for St. Johnston as well.
Adam poised with that. You get the corner kick off out of it, but again, rather anemic. And they've really got to keep the momentum going on this. Person's up there, but he's got the two big men beside him, Dodds and Kernahan. And touched away, in fact. By the same man, Kernahan. O'Boyle on his own. Well, Well, I don't think he was aware of Adam coming in behind him there. He was confident enough, though. I think that personifies the difference in the two teams at this stage. Well, when the two goes up, and you said, Alan, it does a lot for morale.
Paul Ritchie out of jail there, he's let that ball bounce. Defender should never let the ball bounce, especially not 25 yards from your goal.
Samal, no, the referee doesn't protect him this time. All picked up by Adam here. That's the far post and Fogel can't get into it. There's O'Neill. Certainly wouldn't argue with Paul Sturrock because he knows the Saints players much better than I do, but I must say the name of Paul Kane would come to mind as well as John O'Neill for man of the match.
He's played really, really well, Paul Kane, midfield. He hasn't given the ball away too many times. Good pinger of the ball. He can put pass the ball 15 yards. He's quite happy to switch the play, 20 and 30 yards, Paul. And I think he's been a major man. Well, you haven't seen too much of Stevie Fulton tonight, Paul.
He also coaches the under-18s of Perth, so no doubt he's got a managerial future for Peckham. And here is McPherson. A little fellow has mixed well with the Hearts. Here's Fulton. A lock. They're certainly defending the lead now, Alan, all right. Getting everybody behind the ball. Everybody's behind the ball now. Even Samar and O'Boyle had come right back almost to the edge of the penalty area.
They did the right thing by trying to get the ball out wide. Big Davies come back inside and all he's done is bring the bodies in. It was a good run from Adam, but couldn't get the cross in.
Well, again, Hamilton looked a little bit flat-footed there. You know, he wasn't expecting the ball to be played to him.
I think you're absolutely right. I did say that St Johnson did just look as if they've got that yard quicker step.
It's a better run forward. McKinnon tried to get in, and that's a great save. Well, there's the touch of a quality goalkeeper who's hardly had anything to do tonight, and he can produce this.
Well, how many times have we seen that tonight? Not many from Hearts. Taking someone on, driving into the air. McKinnon does really well. Cuts on to his, maybe not so much favour, but he's right. Great save.
They've got to keep this pressure going hard so they stand any chance at all.
At least Jim Jeffries will be quite happy with that, though, because they haven't seen enough of that tonight, Hearts.
By Adam giving away, this is a counter attack. Brilliant tackle that time by Stevie Fulton. That was the most timely tackle he's made in the game because there was nobody behind him. That could have been the killing off of Hearts. Well, he's as if he's wanting providential aid now.
Was he looking up at you there, or was he looking up a little higher?
Away it goes. There's Bert van Lingen to the left-hand side. Who's that gentleman with the glasses on? Former Rangers captain and manager, John Gregg. Samar held that very well. There's simply more cunning in this St Johnson side. I mean, individually, they've got players like Kane, O'Neill, and now, clearly, Samar from that little cameo, who can hold the ball.
Well, that's what we're looking for. If they can hold the ball up front, kill a little bit of time and keep possession, that will frustrate Hearts even more. He's done well, Samar, tonight. I haven't seen him too many times, but tonight, I've been very impressed, very quick.
And brave. Look at the pushing going on here. Now Kitongo, this is what he likes, going into the penalty area like this. That's a good ball across, and it's touched away again. logo coming from the left-hand side. It seems an absolute set. He would put it away, but no.
It's a great ball from Kutongo. I think you'll see it comes off of McQuillan. Good defending by him.
Just beyond Weir. And a wee fellow here, if given the ball in the right territory, could cause difficulties. That's a better effort by Hamilton. And this is the kind of momentum that the Tynecastle side now need to keep going.
Well, this is why they brought him on. They want to get the ball down there. Jim gets ahead onto it, just can't get it on target. But you've got to look to get Kutong. If he's going to start taking players on down that right-hand side, you give him the ball as much as you can to get balls like this into the box. And maybe one of those from Jim Hamilton and another might just find its way into the back of the net.
Well, St. Johnson's certainly living a little bit dangerously, perilously at the moment, but they've only got 20 minutes to hold out or to increase their lead. In fact, here's Flogo. I think he's going to get himself cornered in it. Hard to get his freedom. Supported by McKinnon. Tries to get it down the left side again. That's where his, but he's naturally disposed to getting it to his left foot. And I think we're having substitution. Now Lowndes is coming on. Nathan Lowndes, who came on round about this stage against Kilmarnock, stepped up and scored a beautifully measured goal. Well, he's played well. Portuguese player who, as I said on Saturday, he might not have been warned about the Scottish weather, and he felt it looked terribly fragile, but he's come through the test tonight.
Well, most definitely, he's played very well, Samal, but when you have another weapon like Nathan Lowndes who's come on and done so well, scored a goal on Saturday, and it's a luxury that Sandy has. And he's worked his socks off, Samal, so fresh legs for St Johnston. And remember, they are taking a chance at the back half, so probably not such a bad idea by Sandy Clark bringing that kind of situation on, because if it's man for man at the back, you maybe know Nathan Lowndes will just sneak another one, and this tie is over.
And going away across to that left-hand side. Logo, McKinnon. Well, not a bad ball in, that deceived Alan Bain. There must have been a little bit of swerve in that in the wing. Up it goes again, and that's a bit of all yesterday. And for the first time in the game, Adam got some space inside the box and angled it away.
It's another great ball, and this time it's Stephen Adam that gets his head onto it right across the goal. Main's beat here, just too wide. But this is the kind of pressure that Hearts are going to have to keep on St Johnston. This is the time. I thought Flugel had done too much. He does well to get the ball over. Big Davy Weir gets it back in again. Unfortunately, you'll see Adam said just why. Main was definitely beaten though.
Lowndes got his first touch there. Boyle, the light for stuff, here's Lowndes. Couldn't get away from Ritchie though. And they get the free kick. Although I think Hearts have got to nick something in the next 5 minutes or so, it's going to be extremely difficult for them.
All of a sudden it's the clock that's against them as well, isn't it?
There's the tackle. Lowndes, 21 years of age, started his football with Leeds. He went to Watford. Hamilton. Yes, I think the referee is exactly right. Road to St Johnston. Again, Hearts got boxed in a way down on this left-hand side. That's laid out to Adam. And there's Hamilton. Too many legs in front of him, though. There was a handball, I think. That's Devin McPherson.
But they'd be trying to get in front of Lowndes, because a bit of a flankle there. But the ball definitely hit his arm. The big man's nose made the chop onto the glass there.
Yes. Certainly does his calisthenics well, Davy. Up it goes. There he is again. Okay. Took this pass well. corner kick. A little bit of a combination between two of the best men on the field, John O'Neill and Paul Kane. Well, John O'Neill was 6 years at Tannadice, of course. Very well known to Paul Sturrock. Obviously Paul's pal, obviously. Dipped in again. Get it to that left foot again. There's a Boyle. Balls up. Well, that's a very good effort, you know. The penalty area was so congested.
It shows good control here. Remember, he can't tackle it. It's a good run from Preston to try and take him away. It looked a lot closer. Nice quick turn here. You can just see he's always spinning away from goal.
Well, that, I think that would have excelled even. Gold Island personally put that one in. The Congo, I think, is going to be St. Johnson's throw. Lyon's got the touch. Go to Hearts. But despite all the energy expended, all the opportunities they've had in the last 10 minutes, the game is certainly drifting St. Johnson's way. And they know it. Boyle again. Well, St. Johnson reasserting themselves again, but they have pulled. Dodds out of position. Can they take advantage? A bit too slow. Fulton. Now Weir. Dodongo. Off he goes again. Bolin harassing him, and he does get the free kick, and Bolin's annoyed about that.
He's keeping the pressure on him, not letting him go on his major run.
Well, he's waiting until David Weir goes right into the middle of the box. A wasted one again, but Weir did get the touch, but there's no hot square going in for the jugular there, which is surprising. Mighty clearance there by Alan Mayne, away by Ritchie. Here's Flogo. Yes, O'Neill. Brought down, free kick.
Great skill by John O'Neill there. Great turn. Google most definitely brings him down.
What I like about the St. Johnson team, which I mentioned on Saturday again, was this nice balance that they have. There's the outside run by McQuillan, which he does occasionally, as I pointed out. He does judge the right moment to come forward, and he almost got it again. Almost sticked his way down the right-hand side. That neat balance they have on the side. You know, Kane and O'Neill and Dasovic, the same kind of players, you know, the precise players get involved. You have a good midfield.
Going to be very competent tonight, St. Johnston. And apart from, I think they've probably still been happy with 1-0, never mind 2-0 after Preston's cracker.
There goes again, and that's almost in there by Lowndes. Just beyond Preston. And Weir had to take his time because really there was nobody downfield. Had to cut it back to Rousseff. Well, Kane again was the one who was convinced about getting the ball there. And he had two Hearts players not quite sure of themselves. Now Weir. Took his eye right off that. I think he's been so intent to get forward at them that
I'll tell you what happened there. Actually, Gary Bolin was magnificent there. He set off to make sure he knows, so that Katongo knows if he gets the ball, Gary Bolin's going to be beaten down his neck, And he's looking at Boland, not the ball.
That's a better piece of play though. Fulton comes forward. Adam was a bit wide and again spoiled by that extra pass. It could have been played inside. Pogba was going through on the left as well. Just too often Hearts seem to turn away from goal. Weir and McPherson both up for this. And Alan Bain, no difficulty there, getting off the top of a dam's head. Offside, I think. I think Sandy Clark's screaming at Lyons to watch that.
I think he said the words a little harsher than that. Lyons standing up there himself. He should be looking along the line, don't want to get caught offside. All you need to do now is give the Hearts possession.
Here's McKinnon, didn't quite get the 1-2. Well meant. Does get the throw, and he's got to thrust forward a bit more now on the left. Up they go, touched him back, and Jim Hamilton didn't like that ball. Well, Weir just a little bit slower. I think Weir must have felt that one of the central defenders would have got that. A little bit surprised the ball went through. He's offside again.
I think David McPherson can take him on and put him on the mantelpiece. Lyons is not looking along. He's looking at the ball, not looking where Big Dave is going to be going either. And all that doing is a little bit naive there from Lyons. You've got to be aware that Big Dave is going to look to get possession back, push out in the kick there. And that's when you've got to look for maybe one of your wider guys to come in and go behind.
Well, nobody was behind there, that's for sure.
Also, Alan Main has to realise that's going to happen as well, actually, and he has to give it a little bit of air rather than driving it so it's hanging. And gives Lyons a better chance to win the ball. Jim, a lot to think about.
A look of resignation there about Jim Jeffries. Much less animated than Sandy Clark. Dasovic. Logo. Good defending by McQuillan though. Yes, I think the goal kick. As McQuillan, boy from Stranraer originally, came from Dundee of course. Good buy at £87,000.
It is nowadays. Done well, done very, very well. The whole St Johnstone team have done well. You wouldn't really say that they haven't deserved the lead in this game at the moment.
Oh, held back there again. Away by Dodds, that's a good ball by Logo. Slung in well, and Adam was coming in there. Good up and under there by Gary Boland. It doesn't make much ground all the same. There's Weir. O'Neill right on the spot again. Good defensive play by Neil that time. McPherson. Katongo still in play. That's a good ball. McPherson's up there. There's Katongo weaving his way in. And Alan Main should get that. Yes, indeed, as Kogel came in. And I think Lyons has taken a knock. Gone down there with about just under 7 minutes of the game remaining, and it I must say it now looks beyond Hearts unless some miracle happens. So little time left for them to lift themselves up. And as you said about the St Johnstone, have been playing so well recently, good basis established, want us to stay by our panelist tonight, Paul Sturrock. The transition, sometimes it can work for a manager, sometimes not, as you know, Alan, but he's been handed the battle, as we said earlier, and he's striding on. There's been no faltering.
No, absolutely not, and I think nice by Paul to say that, you know, Sandy has added his own bits and pieces in there, and certainly done a great deal. And after all, his first job here was in the League Cup, and they had a great result against Hibs, and he's only carried that on. And if anything, I suppose, if you were going to try and tip the game tonight, it's definitely St Johnstone that are the form team, no question of that, because this is a shadow of the team that we saw last year in the half of the road.
Well, Sandy Clark hasn't got long to endure. 6 minutes, just under. Lowndes is on his own. Can he take him? Lowndes is going in. Very good run by Lowndes. Great save. Ronnie came on Saturday and scored the most exquisite goal, and he was almost on the verge of doing the same that time.
Shows great pace, doesn't he, in between the defenders, gets his shot on goal, which is in target. And then really important, does so well here, in between the two defenders, good determination, gets his shot on.
Here's Fulton going in for this. That'll be a throw. And when you get to this stage in the game and you're really, you feel it's going away from you and you're surging after it, sometimes you can be a little bit clumsy and over-anxious. Another two signs of that in this Hearts team now. St. Johnson trying to kill the game off in the breakaway. There's no offside. Roussier has made the challenge out. He comes and he gets there. He's out of goal though. Boland trying to come in. With Roussi well out of his goal, couldn't make contact. Looked like there was a push there though, even though Weir handled it. And under 5 minutes to go with some stoppage time, obviously. But increasingly it looks like a Rangers St. Johnson final. Put in there by Locke. And McKinnon. Logo. Weir is up. By Kernahan. There's Kane. Beautiful play by Kane again. Oh, Preston delayed that. Dasovic and a ball away across on the other side. Lowndes with it. Two goals up, all they need to do is hold on to the ball. That was a distinct opportunity. Good run through to Lowndes. Oh, Boyle's inside, and there it is. That's it. St. Johnson are in the final without the slightest doubt. And that was a clean, clinical goal, which I think typifies and summarizes their superiority.
Well, it's a good goal because Preston at one point could have swung the ball away to the left. Held possession, it's a great run from Nathan Lowndes, great cutback, bang, 3-0. The Boyle deserves that, he's played well. This young lad's got a great future, hasn't he? Showed good determination 2 minutes ago, an unselfish run into the box, great cutback, and Giorgio Ball makes no mistake.
The other good thing about this young lad, he comes to Scotland at the age of 21. Sometimes we're getting them when they've been slightly past their best, but this young boy has now contributed twice in two games, enough to convince me he has great quality. And Lowndes, with any pressure at all in this game, well, look at this, there still is a little bit of aggro going on. Any pressure, I think, was beginning to ease off St. Johnson, and then, of course, that finally did it. Good, organized, competent performance. I think we're getting another substitution here. It looks like Alan Preston it is, yeah. Who's coming off, and McFan is coming on.
Maybe just waste a little bit of time. He's done well as well, Alan Preston. Did well for the goal there, because he could have thrown the ball over, didn't do that, held possession, and then the size build up, they got the third goal, which called it off.
Well, you know, I hope when St. Johnson go to the final, they deserve a huge support. 29th of November. Lowndes. Yes, that's a free kick. Wild tackle by Ritchie.
Well, I would like to think, actually, that those who have not travelled through here tonight, watching the game tonight, they'll be desperate to go to the final after this kind of performance.
Kane. Dodge tried to come up on it. apart from anything else, I think Jim Jeffries is now going to stop the rot. I said they haven't won a game away from Tynecastle domestically since the start of the season, and that for a team that played so splendidly last season isn't good enough. That was offside. Difficult to put your finger on one precise thing about the Hearts at the moment. It just seems to be a malaise about them. And here is O'Boyle going off, and it's Grant coming on now. Look at the delight in his face. Well, he's been on the bench, but you can see it's all about the team and the club.
Most definitely, they all played really well. And the Hearts thought they had it easy at the point. Difficult at the back. Big Roddy coming on. Big Roddy Grant has been around. He'll cause them plenty of problems.
Well, I don't know if Paul Sturrock will speak to me again, but I think Kane is my man of the match. Would you back me up on that?
Yeah. I think we haven't maybe seen just so much of John O'Neill in the second half. Certainly Paul's been involved in mostly everything, but it'd be very difficult to pinpoint one person because they all have played well. Even Big Dan Dodge at the back hasn't lost too many headers. And I think Sandy Clark would be loath to single out someone. This has been a superb team effort tonight and really have been that yard quicker than Hearts.
And I think it's also going to be a very good final because Rangers are playing very well at the moment. I like the way that St Johnson play, so we can look forward to that. We'll see that live, of course, on Scottish. And it's picked up by Locke off the back of the heel of Weir. Maybe agreed right at the start of the second half as well, Alan. There was always the potential for the breakaway by St Johnson. It came perhaps a little bit later than we might have expected. There's Gary Bolin. Here's Lowndes again. Grant is running on that left-hand side. Lowndes trying to go in on it. And Rousset, ooh, he just controlled himself. There was a Gallic eruption there. And I think the referee might have one or two harsh words and a booking for Lowndes. Well, I don't know about that. Rousset's right foot was a little bit reckless.
He's gone into trying to protect himself. But I've got to say that Lowndes has maybe gone in a little bit late there, and I think Willie Young booked him there.
Well, Willie Young brings the game to an end, and there we are. St Johnston in the final of the League Cup for the first time in 30 years. A wholly comprehensive victory at the end of the day in terms of the goals they scored, the way they defended, controlled midfield with two outstanding players, as far as I'm concerned, with an Elan Kane. And they did it this way. The first goal coming up here after brilliant goalkeeping by Rousset. He simply wasn't good enough to keep that shot by Dasovic out. And how about this one? Maybe the pièce de résistance, using the language that Rousset himself uses more fluently. He couldn't get to that. And then again, that goal at the end, whipped in as the ball came forward from an excellent move by Lowndes. And there's a delight in the face of a man who's, as I said, there was a shadow over the way he left Tynecastle. He wasn't admitting it to me personally as I spoke to him before the game, but I asked him about how he would feel personally about beating Hearts, but you could tell he's deeply satisfied. He wanted that for himself, apart from these supporters and the St Johnson players. They deserved it, Alan.
Yes, most definitely did deserve it. I'm sure it just makes it a little bit sweeter for Sandy Clark. Hearts have a bit of a mountain to climb. They are not the team we all looked at last year, but I think it would be very, very cynical to say that St Johnson didn't deserve this tonight. In all departments, it was superb. O'Neill and, I think, impressive Paul Kane impressed me in midfield, and superb for them.
And now we can hear from the man who must be absolutely delighted, Sandy Clark.
Sandy, that's the first notch on your belt, a final, the first one in 28 years in the League Cup.
Honestly, worst can't explain how I feel about my players. It's all down to them. They've played really well for the past 6-7 weeks, and I think tonight, you know, in the performance, they thoroughly deserve the victory, and by the three goals.
goals were absolutely terrific, particularly in the first half. The two goals, it took you into the second with a great psychological advantage.
The two goals were great together. I really feel we had four or five very good chances in the first half. In the second half, obviously, Hearts have come at us. They were defending well, as we normally do, and the lads up front, obviously, we're getting another goal.
Now, Alan Main, special mention for him, a number of key saves.
He did very well, but he's a marvellous goalkeeper. I think he should be not far away from the Scottish squad. I think he proved that tonight. There's one or two of my lads have opened a few eyes, I'm sure, tonight.
How do you feel about doing it against Hearts, the team that let you go?
It doesn't matter. St Johnson's in the final, that's all that matters. That's the most important thing. It doesn't matter who you be. I feel sorry for German Valley, but if I'd be going to the final, it's near a sort of fair chance.
A monumental task against Rangers, but congratulations.
What a chance, well done, thank you very much.
Andy Clark speaking to Neil Henderson. He's delighted he should be St Johnson through by 3-0. We'll look back at the action after this short break. Hi, welcome back to Easter Road. St Johnson, the winners, of course, by 3-0. Let's go down and hear from a jubilant Nick Dasovic, who is with Neil Henderson.
Just getting your breath back after an exceptional performance by St Johnson. And in the first half, it took 5 minutes to kill Hearts' ambitions of a final place.
Yeah, it was a tough game. I don't think we played as well as we could have played, as we've shown in the last few weeks. But going into the cup game, you don't have to play pretty football as long as you get in the final. And that's what we did tonight. And it was a good determined effort by every one of us. And, we got two goals in two crucial times. I think we killed them off early then. But then, they came out of the second half, so it was definitely... put out the fight for the second half, but who was it? George scored the last goal, so it's great.
Yeah, you love scoring key goals. You did it against Celtic and now against Hearts and a final place. You love the big occasion, don't you?
I just like scoring goals. Not so much key goals. I've not got many goals, but it'd be great to be in the final. And looking forward to meeting Rangers, so it'd be great.
It's turned St Johnson around. Congratulations.
Cheers, Nick.
Nick Dasovic there. He sounds a happy man. He should be, Paul.
I'm delighted for everybody involved with St Johnson tonight. From chairman downwards. They've merited all the accolades they're going to get for this, because it's been a quality season for them, and a team that's come of age, I believe, and I do believe I even fancy them for the final.
Yeah, Hearts so disappointing again, Craig, tonight.
Yeah, slightly better in the second half, but it's too late by then. I mean, given a team of St Johnson's strengths and organisation and work rate, you're not going to get back from 2-0 then.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's have a look at that first goal again, Dasovic. He takes it so well.
He's just come out of the box here and he just gets onto it in a half volley, and he scored a couple of goals this season. He had very few for me over the last two or three seasons, but he's played a wee bit deeper when I've used him before. But
he could easily have skied that shot, but he's controlled it well.
He's got his body just over it perfectly here, and as I said, the goalie's unlucky. Actually, I think he's unsighted.
And Craig, the second goal, again, you said at half-time you wouldn't really fault the defenders, but he's given so much space here.
Yeah, he just missed there, but he's given a lot of space. But, to hit the ball from that distance and to put it in that top corner, as I said already, that's just a wonderful striking goal.
Paul, what does it mean to St Johnson as a club to reach this major cup final?
Incredible. For so long now, it's last year, trying to stay up, it was a difficult season for them, and as I've said already, I do believe a lot of players there have come of age. And it's a team game that way at St Johnson. Mm-hmm. They all like their being together, and they work so hard together. And from the chairman, as I said already, the chairman downwards, it'll be a fantastic night for them.
Craig, Jim Jeffries did change at half-time. He brought on Katongo and Flogel, and we can see two or three chances coming up where they did have a chance to score, but they couldn't quite get that breakthrough they needed.
Yeah, this was a crucial point in the game, because Alan Mains made a wonderful save. I think it goes through the legs here of Darren Dodds, sees it late and he gets down, pushes it around the post, and that would have made a big difference to the game. But to be fair, St Johnson didn't deserve to lose the game.
Yeah, and another chance coming up. Katongo, he did make a difference, Paul, and he gets this ball whipped across.
Yeah, and it's John McCullen actually blocks I don't think he knows he does it, but he actually blocks the header coming in. Katongo caused a wee bit of concern for 10-15 minutes with some accurate crosses.
And here's this header coming up from Stefan Adam. Cross coming in from David Weir, Craig.
Yep, good ball back in. And I think, was it Stefan Adam coming into the back post across the face of the goal? But again, there's three or four St Johnson players round about him. Mm-hmm. And that was one of the key things about the game. They always got players round about the ball.
And this third goal, which just killed it, Paul, it was great work from Lowndes, who came on as a substitute.
It was on all most of the second half, actually. They broke three or four times down channels, and he does really, really well here. And George, front post run, and this clinical finish from, I thought George O'Boyle had a... And it, a good game, you know, and I do believe that he merited his goal. He's not scored too many this season, but I think lately he got a couple lately, and I think that's given him the confidence again.
And Greg, hats off to St Johnson tonight. They were quite superb.
Yes, I'm very pleased for the players and for Sandy Clark. He's a smashing man and a smashing manager. I just feel a little bit sorry for the Hearts, everybody involved with the club. But that's football, as you say.
And very briefly, Paul, you hinted you think they might do something in the final, briefly.
Well, the confidence they'll take from this, as I've said already, and, you know, I think they could definitely go on and cause a bit of damage.
OK, we shall see you live and exclusive on this channel on November the 29th. That's all we've time for tonight. Thanks very much to Paul Sturrock and Craig Levine for joining me. Join me again on Friday for Extra Time at 6 o'clock with top stories and interviews as ever. And we're back on Sunday for ScotSport, highlights of all five Premier matches, including Kilmarnock versus Celtic. Thanks for watching. Good night.
Move up.